Barbara waited 16 months before she acted. She tried to make this work, and it just escalated. And she got to a point where she did not feel comfortable going to work and doing her duties as a city employee. She continues to feel harassed, and she feels like she has no other option. She's asking the courts to take all of this into consideration to please just issue a no contact order so that she can just go back doing her job in a safe environment, Judge.
Thank you, Ms. Barbara. All right, Mr. Williams, would you like to make a closing statement?
Yes. She may have believed to be afraid in her mind, but I have given her no reason to be afraid. I'm actually more afraid. When someone tells a story on you, you know how bad it could get. And look where I'm at here today because of her lies. 16 months she says that she's been going through this. However, she has no documentation from HR. That's the first thing. I took the proper channels. When I knew some issues going on, I went to her director. I verbally went to him first. Then after that, I did a formal complaint with him and HR. Then after that, that's when the investigation started.
So these are things you're talking about are not things that were testified about, and so I can't consider that. I can only, your closing statement has to tie together the things that were actually presented in the evidence on the witness stand.
She has not been honest. She's been proven to not be honest. I had a witness here that stated some of the interactions she's had with her. On two occasions, she's even lied on her. And if you lied once, you basically, how can we trust you? And then, you know, the mayor even stated in the meeting, she said that I was seething at the mouth. The mayor said, oh, no, you wasn't seething at the mouth. He said, you were calm. But, you know, she can fabricate a story, and I don't understand why she chose me. I believe it's apparent because she doesn't like to take direction. I never tell her what to do. I always ask. I said, when it came to the Summer Youth Program, I said, have you applied for grants so we can get more kids working? She has yet to do that. And you know, it's just, it hasn't been a good working relationship, but I am just as important. I took an oath for these citizens here. I don't block anything for these citizens. There's been blockage when it comes to Ms. Colson and Carter. When I ask her to do something, when I ask her how's things go, when I ask her, hey, this should be for the low wealth community. This program was supposed to start out for the low wealth community, but she went against me, and now anybody can get a job. For some of you, that is not going to help Goldsboro. We have a high poverty level. I'm just, you know, she's ruined my business. You go by my business, and you may not see two or three people there all day. You know, because she has lied, like I'm going to misuse children. Why would I want to misuse children when I was the one that pushed for some of you program? Because when I was in New York, I couldn't get a job as a kid. But guess what? My cousins did. My aunt had 11 kids.
Mr. Williams, that's the end. So, not anything's been in testimony. So.
I'm not perfect. I don't have a journey. She's costing me time and energy. You know, where I could be helping the community, I'm here fighting a false claim. Thank you.
So what strikes me about this whole situation is, first of all, you're here asking for a restraining order under Chapter 50C of the General Statutes. It's very specific. Number one, any types of sexual conduct, it's clear that we're not talking about that. And then the second part is stalking, which, as Ms. Barbara referred to, on more than one occasion, following or otherwise harassing, as is defined in the criminal code, which is conduct directed at a specific person that torments, terrorizes, or terrifies that person, and that serves no legitimate purpose. And it goes on to say that the offense of harassment is willfully, on more than one occasion, harasses another person without legal purpose or willfully engages in a course of conduct directed at a specific person without legal purpose, and the defendant knows or should know that the harassment or the course of conduct would cause a reasonable person to do any of the following: fear for the person's safety or suffer substantial emotional distress by placing that person in fear of death, bodily injury, or continued harassment. I don't doubt that there's not some proper action between y'all, but I don't think it's a 50-50. I don't think that this is the kind of case where these facts that y'all described to me belong. But I'm not commenting on anything else, any personnel avenue, any other civil kind of matter avenue, anything else out there. That may be there. But I just don't see this fact scenario fitting what the 50C statute is attempting to target. That's my decision on that. So I'm not going to enter the restraining order here. I think this is a personnel matter. This is a city matter. I don't see this as being a 50C type case. That's my opinion.
Thank you, Scott. Anybody got any questions or comments on what you've heard?
Nope.
I'd just like to know, why didn't we hear what she stated pertaining to getting help from the employees here to write the memorandum, and also that she stated that there was certain councilmen that were going to be a buffer to help her against me. Why didn't we listen to that as well? I think that's very important. She stated that IT helped her and was going to help her with whatever she needed. So those are important factors. You can't just, you know, play a piece of it. But thank you for at least playing it.
If you would like any particular portion of the tapes, or the council could decide.
I just addressed it, so
I just tried to get to the end.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So if they want to listen to it again, they know it's there.
Any more comments? All right. If not, we'll have a motion to go into closed session to read the investigative report. Is that?
Discuss a personnel matter.
And discuss a personnel matter. Is there a motion?
Motion to go into closed session to read the report.
And discuss a personnel matter.
Discuss the personnel matter.
Got it. Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. All right. As soon as you kind, fine folks leave, we'll be in closed session. back in open session to discuss the closed session, I guess. Any comments from anyone to start with?
I think we've all read the report. We've got to decide when we're going to have a hearing.
Well, I think a couple things. And Councilman Ware, I'm going to say this to you. I think, first of all, I know that you don't, I think that you believe you're innocent. I think that's my heart, and I think you're the victim. I do think that. I think that no matter who did the report, if it didn't exonerate you, you weren't going to agree with the report, based on the conversation we've had. I do think that the majority of us sitting here do believe and can honestly say that at some point or another, on occasion, we've seen you create a hostile work environment.
What's a hostile work environment?
You know what a hostile
environment? Explain that to me. Elaborate.
Let me go through. I think that the EEOC clearly states that when one...
The EEOC is not involved with this, sir, nor have there ever been a claim or a complaint. No, because you're wrong. So I'm going to correct you, because you'll have these people thinking that EEOC came and did a report. They did not do a report. There was never a report filed by Ms. Simpson Carter. No, I have to interrupt you if you're wrong, sir.
We don't need to be having discussions. Okay, if we're going to talk and we're going to act civil. If you're not going to
I am acting civil.
Everybody here has the same right to talk.
I'm acting civil, sir.
Everybody here
I'm just debating.
Without being interrupted.
I'm just debating.
I have the floor right now. You can debate after I have the floor, okay?
Go ahead.
All right, so anyway, the EU states that when one's conduct explicitly or inexplicitly interferes with an individual's work performance or creates a hostile or intimidating work environment, it's a violation of the Title VII Civil Rights Act. This report clearly indicates that it is clear that the city can be found liable for your acts as a council member. This report clearly states that Councilmember Williams has engaged in behavior that puts the city at risk for failing to protect the employee from your retaliatory conduct.
There's no retaliatory conduct on my part. That came from Mr. Cole Simpson Carter. I was the first one to file this complaint, so I'm going to address that.
Okay,
she didn't file her complaint through the proper channels. She went to the district court opposed to going through her grievance process with the city of Goldsboro.
All right, Councilman Williams, it goes on to say, I think this is important for you to hear. If Councilman Williams continues to display animosity and continues to subject Ms. Carter to additional criticism and disrespect, the city council could be held liable for failing to take sufficient action. We have said time and time that you need to quit your attacks against council.
I have no attacks against her. I use my First Amendment rights, and I remove myself from someone who has lied on me and disrespected my community. So I'm not going to sit in someone's face who went to court and stated all these false facts. And I have explained that. I've asked our interim city manager to get me a liaison. Nothing has been done. And there's been no retaliation against her. She hasn't been demoted. She hasn't been moved to another job. So I have no power to harass her or to dismiss her from her job or any of those things.
Right, and then the last thing I would say to you, we only have 6 or 7 months left as a council. It's my hope that we get this resolved, we get over this, and we can work together in unity, and we can try to work together. I think that that's what our citizens deserve. I think that's what they expect, and I hope that we can figure out a way to do that. I think it's really important. I also think that the city's ethic code, I want to read this, provides the following: a violation of this code of ethics may subject the mayor or any council member to a censure resolution by the citizens of Goldsboro City Council. However, no such censure resolution shall be adopted until the person alleged to have committed the violation has been given notice of alleged violation, which you have not been given, and provided the opportunity to appear before the board and be heard regarding this allegation. So I think if the council decides they want to censure you, then we will have to give you a notice, and then you'll have your time to come before the board with all the due process, all the evidence, anything that you want to submit. Would be the way to move forward. So I think it's at this point, there's no point to continue the conversation. The question is, does the council want to do this, move forward with this or not?
I'd like to say something.
Sure,
Mayor. We have a document that's 78 pages. And within that document are numerous statements made by city employees, which have been called to be lies or untruths. The investigation has been called unbiased, biased towards the city and against Councilman Williams. He has suggested that statements made by employees were lies, which would question their integrity and their professional ethics. I can't believe that these upstanding city employees deliberately lied and made statements of this nature. His actions has put the city at risk. He's brought dishonor.
Dishonor? I disagree with you, sir. I have been positive through this whole ordeal. I guess you couldn't understand it because, Mr. Councilman Hamm, you hadn't had to go to district court and someone say that you, to stop you from sodomizing, harassing them, and stalking them. So until that happens to you, you probably will never understand my situation, sir.
Therefore, I think we should take some action.
Well, to add to that, if you're going to take action on one side, you have to look at action on another side. We all heard the court, part of the court hearing from that was played, and it was found that I can't even remember the exact number that she stated, that 50C, that it was found to not be held up in court, basically. And if Ms. Chacole went to file paperwork on someone, I mean, we're just going to be on Councilman Williams, and the paperwork was untrue, isn't that some grounds to have some type of discipline for her as well? Because we can't, we're saying, Mr. Hamm at one point is saying that the employees have so much integrity, but then if you have that much integrity, you shouldn't go file a false claim.
Stop your moment, because I don't know where that line is.
Oh, okay, that's fine. I don't know where it is either, but we were just talking. Yeah. I mean, I'm just saying because I'm just using.
I'm not saying you can't say it. I'm just saying.
Yeah, I'm just using what he just said, and I'm just putting it into a different text. That's all. So I don't know if I can say it or not.
Anybody starts getting over that line, crossing that line, you're going to need to stop us, okay?
All right. Well,
let me clarify.
If you start to discuss any disciplinary action about an employee, then that is
okay.
Needs to be back.
Let me clarify my statement. When I talk about integrity and professional ethics, I'm not speaking of necessarily Chacole. I'm speaking of the other people who make statements.
And that's fine. I'm not saying anything about them or anything. I'm just saying as we talk in general, if whether it's any employee or whatever, but we do have an incident where we're having this happen right in front of us. So my thing is you got to question the integrity at that point, and you have to look at it as, okay, well, something's not right. I'm myself, like in Councilman Williams, I mean, during my election, like I told you before, the other night, I had an uncle say that I told him that I was going to kill him, so all of a sudden I know two police roll up on me at the election spot and I have to walk down to the magistrate office. He's like, ask me, did I want to walk or did they want to put the handcuffs on me? I said, I walk. And the allegations turned out to be false, totally dismissed. So to me, my family doesn't look at my uncle the same anymore, because he told a lie. They know he told a lie. You know what I mean? And a lot of people in the community doesn't look at him the same. Because, outside of that, I don't look at him the same. My uncle's always been a stand-up guy to me. You know what I mean? So it was the biggest shock of my life. So that's why I say you have to question that at the end of the day. I mean, regardless of the situation, it has to come into your mind a little bit, because it could happen to any of us, and we have to put up some safeguards, if possible, or some kind of action, I don't know, or whatever, to make sure that, if you do file something, that you're filing something that is hopefully truthful, and not going to waste the court's time or our time or anybody else's time for that matter. Even now, I think if a woman says a man hit her or something, it comes out to be false, she gets some type of charges now. It's the law's changing because of all the lies and allegations. So I just think we need, if we're going to look at it from one stance, we have to look at it from the other as well.
Okay. Any other thoughts or comments?
The problem I'm having with this report, excuse me, is that no matter whom the lawyer or investigator interviewed, Mr. Williams said they all lied. And I can't believe that every single one of them lied.
I did not say they all lied. I said there was untruths in that thing. And I said there was parts of it missing, sir. It was parts of my statements. I sat with her hours, and I don't see any of that in there.
I mean,
she actually wrote stuff in there that was incorrect from what my statement was.
Can I say something real quick? Just, I'm going to cut you off, but it's only words in the report is one person. So he couldn't have said that everybody lied because there's only one person's words in here. So, I mean, it's one person's story.
She interviewed multiple.
Yeah, people. But I'm saying as far as the words, those words was all from one person. If y'all read it correctly, there wasn't.
Jennifer Collins was mentioned in there.
Mentioned, but the words, even though mentioned, the words still came out of one person's mouth. It was her telling her side of the story. If you read through the report, it wasn't Ms. Collins said XYZ. It was, I talked to Ms. Collins and Ms. Collins might have told me, and then I'm saying this to you now, which is still third party. You know what I'm saying? So it's like the whole report is from one person. So it's not, I mean, all the people that were listed, myself included, it's nothing from any of us in this investigation. Like I said, I spent 3 hours with her. So.
Do we need a motion to?
Well, I think Councilmember Hammond made them. Did you not, or did I think?
I didn't make the motion, but I suggested that we
should
take some action. If a motion is needed, then I'll make a motion that we take action.
And what would that action be?
Well, we have, as I understand it,
you have three different options.
Two or three options here.
Well, again, I just spoke to the city attorney, and he stated he didn't have any recommendations pertaining to this report.
Taken. We can censor Councilman Williams.
Based
just
on what?
Admonition.
Based on what? Based on this fabrication, sir? Based
can
on
finish,
no evidence,
please?
No emails. I have emails.
We can have it.
Member Woods.
I'm talking to him. I can have the floor on debate.
I actually have
but
the floor.
But he's let him make his motion. Let him make his motion.
Go ahead, sir.
We can also, in addition to admonition of for his actions of bringing dishonor to the city council and the city of Goldsboro.
Who has brought dishonor? You have brought dishonor.
We can prohibit access to Ms. Simpson and certain buildings within this complex.
Oh, no, you can't censor me from going through this location. The people, they elected me to be here for transparency.
Would you like to
transparency.
Rebut me when I'm finished? We can also take more drastic action to ask for a recall election to remove him.
That's illegal, sir.
I'm making the comment. I'm not saying that it's legal. Whatever, I'm just saying that's what I propose that it could be done. Or we can just remove him altogether. Action to remove him.
That's a Section 7 amendment, or Section 187.
As a minimum, I would recommend that a letter of admonition to Mr. Williams and prohibit him access to the place where Ms. Carter Simpson works.
I don't go to the place where she works at. I've never went to the place
and
where she worked at.
Any other
if she
place
was
that
so
she might
fearful,
be in this building.
Sir, if she was so fearful, why would she sit in front of me at council meetings? If she was so fearful, and if Ms. Valerie Bateman felt like it,
I have a motion.
If Ms. Valerie Bateman felt that she was in fear, she wouldn't have had me meet in the office building where she's at.
This is a prime example.
Listen.
When he gets sued, then you can have
listen, I have every right to feel this way. I have every right to feel like this, sir. Because this is a mockery. This is double jeopardy. The court ruled, and they sided. They said it was no merit, and we're doing this over again.
Mr. Ham, go ahead.
Councilman Williams, you are demonstrating clearly and patently clear the actions that you're being spoken to about. Your disrespect for other people. And so I think it demonstrates that you don't respect anyone else's opinion or you don't give them opportunity to speak. It's all about you. You're always...
I don't respect lies, sir.
I'm getting off the subject here. That was my...
Yes,
that was
I don't
my,
respect lies.
Will you state your motion, please, sir?
Yes.
Will you state your motion?
It's a lot of confusion in here.
That,
this council is confused.
That Councilman Williams be given a letter of admonition for his actions.
Who gave you that strategy?
And that he be prohibited...
Did the city attorney give you that strategy?
And your next would be prohibited access to where to the council,
yes,
to the
right.
Oh, so have you guys spoke about this?
Without I've had being no in, conversation in with any member of this audience.
I don't believe it.
Yeah, I don't know. Everybody's it. Lying to you, Antonio.
Well, listen.
Right, so Councilor Abraham's motion is that we do the we adopt the censure resolution, but before it can be adopted, we're going to have the hearing. So we'll send the proper letter. If it's voted in, and then we ask that we restrict his access to City Hall. Was that your motion?
Yes.
Is there a second?
Sir.
Is there any discussion?
Yes, there is.
I have one quick thing.
Okay, Commissioner Stevens, the floor is yours.
I don't really particularly, my thing is, the reason why I'm leaving is because of this situation and matters that have been going on today and previously. I could call out several situations of hostile environment. I could call it for all of us. I could call it for all of us. I'm sorry. I could call it for all of us. But truthfully, in this matter of speaking, I am done with this situation. I'm done totally, entirely. I pray whatever comes out, it gets done in the right direction. And if you're going to act out in such ways, in the manner that I've seen both of you gentlemen have acted today, I'm not saying anything but the truth. That man's an attorney.
I wouldn't care what he is. If the man disrespects me, I'm gonna disrespect.
And if the cops gun you down,
then
what?
Well, then I have to deal with that. But he's not a cop, and we're not talking about guns, man. You're not even on subject right now.
I'm on the subject. I'm saying, I'm speaking about the whole thing in general.
You gonna leave? Get up and leave.
I'm not. Fine, I will. Well, go ahead and make the motion and make the vote. My vote is with you guys.
Councilman,
stop,
Mark.
You can't leave.
Sit down, Mark.
He can leave because it's going to still be yes anyway.
Do you have any consequences? Do you have any?
I'm a master? Really? Okay, fine.
Ma'am,
you know what? I'm a slave, right?
I'm protecting.
Because I don't believe in all black people doing. I'm a slave. So yeah, good. Good. Call me a slave.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion?
Yes, it is. I didn't get a chance to discuss it.
I'm going to give you the
floor. Okay. According to our laws pertaining to this particular matter, this hearing, I'm entitled to have an attorney, and this council has to allow me to have legal representation. So I make a motion that this council approve me an attorney so that I am able to defend these false allegations and the sanction.
I second the motion.
We
already have a motion on the floor.
Do you have any other comments?
No.
All right. So right now we have a motion and a second on the floor. All those in favor, raise your right hand. Opposed, likewise. All right, that motion carries. Now, you want to make, well, first before you do that, Attorney Lauren, are we obligated in any way to provide an attorney for Councilman Williams, or is that something he would do personally?
I will research that and get back.
Okay.
According to our ordinance, it states that the council needs to, and I actually have an email from Frieda Bluestein. Let me read that to you.
Well, let's just let it count.
If you want to read the email, you got to let him read it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I don't care to read it.
Okay.
But we're going to follow our attorney's advice.
So far, everything has been wrong.
Okay. He follows her advice.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
I mean, he's mentioned her name several times, so if he has an email with her, so let him say it.
I do. And I also want to ask this question to Attorney Lawrence. October 4th, when I asked you for, when I talked to you about this TRO, you told me that you couldn't represent me as attorney. So I had, at that point, I asked you, could you at least get the TRO complaint? Who gave you the complaint?
Your clerk's office sent it to me.
How would they give you the complaint if you didn't represent me?
It was public record.
It wasn't public record. I didn't get served till the 9th. But you had it on the 4th.
It doesn't matter when you.
And okay, well, let me ask you this: when you sent me the email, why was it two copies? Why was it a draft and then it was a foul copy? Why did you have two different copies of that report?
Whatever was sent to me is what I said.
Did you assist? Did you assist Ms. Carter in filling out this TRO?
Absolutely not.
You were going to get an email you wanted to share with us?
I am going to get it, yes.
If everybody would go ahead and turn your minutes in for your proposal.
And I think that it was kind of unusual not to have Mr. Guthrie up here and speak when he was the main person that I was speaking to through this complaint process. He assured me that everything was going to be fair, and it wasn't. I trusted him. And I trusted the HR director, who never followed with any of the grievances or anything. Now, this is what was sent to Mr. Lawrence, his email. It's GS-168-167. Allows the city to provide a defense to any member of the governing body involving a matter that arises in the scope and course of his official duty. Harassment isn't within the scope of duty, but Valerie Bateman said there was no harassment. She said it was retaliation, and she was wrong on that too, because I was the first one to file a complaint. So the council can't appoint me.
But you said allows. You didn't.
No,
say
no,
that
no.
Too.
It doesn't matter. You allow. So what are you gonna? You're gonna be an unfair mayor. So you have been the whole while, sir.
Are you doing that?
But if you don't listen, someone will pay my legal defense. Someone will. Maybe the federal government will come in and do this, because you were so unfair and the rest of this council was so unfair. So maybe we need to get the federal authorities in here, because this whole thing has been. From the point of this whole process has been wrong. Our city manager, I apologize to you. You don't know what's going on. You just fell into this. But all of the other parties know. So I'm not blaming you. You're here at the intel of this.
Well, you will certainly have your day before
so
the council.
So I made my motion. I made my motion that the council hire me an attorney.
I mean, I'll second it. They're going to deny it, but I'll second it.
Any discussion on that? Mm-hmm. All in favor?
I have discussion.
Okay. Yes, sir.
We've asked Mr. Lawrence to look into it.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to deny it today, but I still want to hear from him and hear what the legal part is.
All right. Any more discussion or questions? All right. All those in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. Opposed, likewise. Motion carries, and we're still asking, Ron, if you would check on that for us. Okay, just to clarify.
You said motion carried.
To deny. I heard motion carried.
You said motion carried. He didn't.
Our motion did carry. What?
He made a motion to get an attorney.
Right, and the two of y'all voted for it, we voted against it.
And you should have said motion denied, not motion carried, but you said motion carried. So, I mean, I'm just.
Thank you for correcting. All right, any other conversation?
I just want to explain the grievance process, the grievance procedure that's in our ordinance. No, you know it, but the people don't know it. And I have the floor. Basically, The purposes of the grievance procedure include providing employees with a procedure by which their complaints can be considered promptly, fairly, and without reprisal. If this investigation for the school administrator, why did it take 7 months? That wasn't quick. That wasn't prompt. That wasn't fair. Encouraging employees to express themselves about the conditions of their work. Promoting better understanding of policies, practices, procedures which affect employees. Increasing employees' confidence that personnel actions taken are in accordance with the established fair and uniform policies procedure. Advise parties, including employees, supervisors, and city managers, of their rights and responsibilities under the policy, including interpreting the grievance and other policies for consistencies of application. And that's the role of the human resource director. She never did any of those things to me. They never updated me on what was going on with this complaint, with my complaint. I'm not talking about that TRO that was filed out of order in the district court. I'm talking about my complaint here. Randy Guthrie, you never followed up with me either. This is your mess.
I didn't know the law was called.
All right, we stand adjourned. Thank you.
I mean, I don't care, but it's not.